Okay, so in the last lecture segment, I talked about the marginal productivity theory of income distribution. And let's go ahead and look at some things that may or may not complicate that story. And the first one to talk about is what we call compensating differentials. So compensating differentials describe a situation where some jobs are more pleasant or unpleasant or dangerous or safe or comfortable or more comfortable, or they offer more opportunities for personal growth and advancement than others. And so with lots of jobs, there are lots of these different side effects or sort of non-monetary benefits. And so what we're typically going to see here is if we have two different job markets. And let's suppose we have a job market for people who are working on the trash truck, and we have a job market for people who are going to wait tables in a restaurant. So let's suppose that the demand curves for both of these jobs are the same. So here's trash collection, and here's dish collection. Well, I've been a busboy, it's not a great job, but it's not that unpleasant. Whereas collecting trash, you know, it's probably a little bit smellier. You have to get up at a really early hour, kind of dangerous actually in terms of how much you might injure yourself and that kind of stuff. So we would expect fewer workers to supply their labor into this market and more workers to supply their labor into the dish market. So because the job is less pleasant and more dangerous, lower level of supply versus that. So what we're going to see here is that we're going to have different levels of wages, even though these two different types of jobs probably embody the same level of skill. So do compensating differentials represent a deviation from this marginal productivity theory of income? And the answer is no, because in each case, the equilibrium wage corresponds to the marginal revenue product of a worker in that market. The marginal revenue product of a worker in this market is higher because there are fewer workers in this market, fewer workers want to be in this market. The marginal revenue productivity of workers in this market is lower because there are more workers in that market. So compensating differentials are completely consistent with the theory of marginal revenue productivity. We could go ahead and look at education and human capital. Now, on one level, probably most of us buy that certain types of training and education or on-the-job experience, and we want to remember that this could be education, formal education, could be on-the-job experience. And actually, sometimes when we talk about human capital, some types of human capital are not things that people have developed. Some of it might be stuff that they're born with. So some people are very outgoing and social, and they're going to make great salespeople. And that's not something they learned in school necessarily. It's just the personality they were born with. So this could be some kind of natural talent. So some people have natural athletic or musical abilities, and that enables them to earn more money, or they're really good with numbers, and you know they're going to be good at math and finance, that kind of thing. So, question of how does human capital impact the idea of marginal revenue product and the theory of marginal revenue productivity? And sort of the default way economists look at it, which is really way too simple, is as if human capital were one kind of thing, that just sort of like the more schooling you get and the more on-the-job experience you have, the higher your level of human capital. But pretty obviously, there are different types of human capital. And in fact, different types of human capital are useful or not on different types of jobs. You know, a personality type is a kind of human capital. And you can see that spontaneity or being methodical, those could be either weaknesses or strengths depending upon the job. If someone's a comedian, spontaneity is probably an asset and being really methodical is maybe not. If someone's an accountant, being methodical is probably an asset, and being spontaneous may not be an asset if you're going to be an accountant. So that's one thing about human capital. A second complication is the issue of, is education an investment in human capital? And certainly as educators, we would like to think so. Or is it what we call signaling? So we sometimes talk about signaling in the context of advertising, that a firm's willingness to engage in advertising and spend a lot of money advertising a product indicates that it thinks its product is likely to be appealing and that it plans to stay in business for a long time. Something that happens with education potentially is probably people who are smarter and more patient and harder working and have an easier time, you know, playing within the rules, probably find it easier to get an education than people who have the opposite traits. People who are just not quite as bright in terms of natural talent, or if they have a hard time playing within the rules or sort of sticking with it, you know, for sticking it out through high school and delaying gratification, that's going to make getting an education harder or less likely. So on this sort of look, on this sort of plan, education is not something that necessarily directly makes you more productive, but it does serve as a test and a signal of your future productivity. So on this model, teachers are more like meat inspectors than they are someone who's actually improving the product, improving their students' abilities. That doesn't mean that education is without value. Someone who's a meat inspector is making the meat market more functional because now consumers can have some degree of certainty over the quality of the food that they're getting. So that's a valuable function out there. Then the last thing that we're going to talk about is going to be issues of discrimination, and that's going to get a lecture video all of its own. So I'll see you there in that next lecture video.